Jeffrey Baird, representing Ruth Cookson in the Social Security Disability Appeal. The administrative law judge didn't give good enough reasons to reject the treating physician's opinion offered by Dr. Hufford in February of 2011. Dr. Hufford had treated the claimant as part of the team for 15 years and found on February 22nd, 2011, very serious hand manual limitations and lifting limitations to 5 pounds frequently, 10 pounds occasionally. And he based it on his years of experience, but also on 2 clinical exams, one on January 4th, 2011, and one on February 22nd. And he also based it on updated x-rays from February 2011. The updated x-rays showed extensive osteoarthritic damage to the base of the thumb joint, the MCP, metacarpophalangeal, on the right, with subluxation, which means the bone is sliding out from under the upper bone, and joint space narrowing throughout the hands and wrists. Based on that objective evidence, Dr. Hufford, yes?
A question here is, I think the reason that the ALJ gave in not favoring Dr. Hubbard was that he wasn't a hand specialist and he didn't refer, despite whatever observations he had, he didn't refer her to a hand specialist. And that seems to appear why he favored Dr. Wang's examination, perhaps over Dr. Hufford. Why is it that specific? I understand,
Judge Brigitte. Dr. Hufford had the effort to cure over a period of years as part of a team. He also did his own firsthand observations, especially January 4th and February 22nd. But Dr. Wang relied on x-rays from 2006 that weren't nearly as severe as the 2011 x-rays. So even though she was a hand specialist, she wrote a year and a half earlier in September of 2009, and she relied on very old x-rays. So the treating physician, relying on the most contemporary x-rays and first-hand observations, set the limitations that he did. He wasn't a hand specialist, that's true, but he did refer the client out for x-rays. So he had updated current.
But not for referral to a hand consultant. We're just trying to figure out when these ALJs have difficult jobs, it's even highlighted when we get to the sort of mental and psychiatric sort of issues. They have two doctors giving two reasons. Which one do they go with? Can we say that he didn't give specific reasons or legitimate reasons, enough to not be substantial or evidence on which their decision was supported? And so you're saying, well, he should have gone with her treating physician, but was there a case that you can say that, when you have this kind of scenario? I know we have tremendous amount of cases for all kinds of scenarios, but I didn't really see one for this one.
Well, Whitmark is a similar one in many ways. Although I see what you're saying, where the ALJ prefers an expert over a treating physician. There are cases that say that. The general hierarchy is outlined in Horn and Lester, those old ones. The effort to cure and longitudinal familiarity is supportive.
I did want to get to the psychiatric sort of examination, because here it looks like we had Dr. Hood versus Dr. Morgan. And so one is the state agency psychiatric consultant, and the other, Dr. Morgan, is a clinical psychologist who examined Ms. Cookson on March 2011, and they came out with very different opinions. And so the ALJ went to a third.
Right.
And the third, I believe, was Dr. Cushion.
Yes.
And he's diagnosed Ms. Cookson, I believe, with recurrent major depressive disorder of mild severity with anxiety and panic attacks, among other aspects, and recommended treatment with antidepressants and supportive counseling. So I'm just trying to figure out, why wasn't that reasonable? Why wasn't that a legitimate reason to go with the third doctor when you had two competing doctors?
We're hanging our hat on the third doctor. Dr. Cushman found, because of the anxiety and panic attacks, it used the word will. The claimant will experience difficulty in maintaining a regular schedule, regular work days, consistent participation. So he found, actually, a very important limitation that taken literally would rule out substantial gainful activity at step five, because you can't rely on 40-hour work weeks, 8-hour days. And that's in the supplemental excerpts of record 409, 410. So that is the crucial statement from Dr. Cushman. Right. But going back to Dr. Wang, expert though she was, she wrote a year and a half earlier in a degenerative context that degeneration caused by osteoarthritis. And she relied on older x-rays, 2006, not 2011.
But then also we look at the credibility determinations that the ALJ made, which when he's looking at these doctor's reports, he's seeing what Ms. Cookson was saying and what her fiancé was saying, and he's looking at what she has told and told different things to various doctors. Put it all together, he comes out with this a decision. I'm just trying to see why that isn't supported.
Well, the client's credibility has some problems. I understand that. But Dr. Hufford, especially in the February 2011 opinion, was not relying on what she said. He examined her hands and saw deformity of the thumb joint. He saw arthritis throughout the hands and wrists. And the elbows couldn't straighten. She couldn't flex or extend the elbows. So those were his observations. They weren't based on relying on her own testimony or her own statements.
Well, but she also, though, testified to all of her daily activities, which the ALJ noted in his assessment, which, you know, seemed inconsistent with the what some of the doctors were saying and what she was claiming.
Well, the daily activities didn't contradict the last opinion by Dr. Hufford. She wasn't, her boyfriend reported that she had trouble handling. She had trouble with her hands. She could lift 5 or 10 pounds. But those are things that Dr. Hufford also found. She engaged in activities, but they were self-scheduled. It wasn't the rigors of the work world. Did she confabulate or say more than she should have? I think she claimed more than she needed to. But I think her doctors pinned down exactly what was going on, especially with the hands. If I could reserve.
You may.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
We'll hear from Mr. Chen.
Good morning, Your Honors. Jeffrey Chen appearing on behalf of Acting Commissioner Carolyn W. Colvin. May it please the Court. Your Honor, I want to begin by addressing, indeed, what the Judge Murgi has pointed out. There is actually 9 separate medical opinion evidence of record here, 7 of which, 4 mental and 3 physical, found that plaintiff is not disabled because she can still perform a range of work activity, among which were constant examiner Dr. Scaramuzzino, state agent physician Dr. Hood, state agent physician Dr. Garcia on the mental side, and on the physical side, constant examiner Dr. Wang, state agent physician Dr. Rubaum, and state agent physician Dr. Spellman.
But we don't just count.
You're right, Your Honor.
And I wanted to ask you something about Dr. Cushman's testimony, or his opinion, rather. Dr. Morgan reported that anxiety disorder that was resulting in depression had become worse over time. And Dr. Cushman is the most recent of the psychological discussions. So why wouldn't that ordinarily be the most probative?
I think the ALJ did, in fact, give weight to the opinion of Dr. Cushman. In fact, the ALJ
except the ultimate result was not what Dr. Cushman had said.
Well, actually, under two things, Dr. Cushman actually stated that claimant was still capable of detailed, complex, simple, and repetitive tasks. The ALJ actually found a more limiting
RFC. But not for a full work week. This seems to be the key, that she didn't have the ability to work a normal work week.
Actually, Dr. Cushman stated two things, that she could deal with stress when she wants to, and that she would have attendance difficulties at this time with complaints of anxiety and malaise. So that statement is explicitly premised upon plaintiff's subjective testimony, which, as has already been adduced, the ALJ properly found was not credible. In addition, the Dr. Cushman stated his opinion in terms of difficulties, which the ALJ was obligated to translate into an RFC. The ALJ recently found that based on the entire record, especially given plaintiff's lack of credibility, that these difficulties would not ultimately prevent her from performing simple and repetitive tasks from a sustained nature for a work week. And that's a reasonable interpretation of Dr.'s opinion, given that these statements explicitly premised on the plaintiff's complaints of anxiety and malaise that the doctor noted in the very same sentence that the doctor wrote about attendance difficulties.
I had a similar question about the physical limitations in terms of the sort of time sequence. The ALJ chose to credit an opinion of Dr. Wang that was backcasting in terms of the objective medical evidence. What is your response to counsel's argument that that Dr. Wang's testimony really isn't even about the same thing as Dr. Hufford's because is looking at much older x-rays?
Well, I have a couple of responses, Your Honor. First of all, claimant alleged disability dating all the way back to October 12, 2006. Dr. Wang did not examine claimant until September 12, 2009, so it's more than 2 years and 8 months after she's alleged disability, making her opinion highly probative to the overall claim that she had been disabled this entire time. Moreover, in terms of Dr. Hufford himself, I wanted to point out that claimant, characterizes Dr. Hufford as, treating for 15 years and as part of a team, but the record indicates that claimant had significant treatment gaps, only saw Dr. Hufford twice from October 2006 and then in January 2011, less than 2 months before her scheduled administrative hearing. He referred to the updated medical records, but in January 10th, 2011, an arthritis panel was used to determine the state of claimant's hand rheumatoid arthritis. The results were entirely negative or normal, and this can be found on pages 381 and 383 of the record. In addition, again, looking at the entire period from 2006 to 2011, we have an actual specialist, not a general practitioner, Dr. Paul Caviol, hand and upper extremity surgeon, who found mild arthrosis that claimant can fully extend her fingers, exert normal grip, full strength, no tenel or phalen signs, which are commonly used to detect carpal tunnel, was in fact referred to a nerve conduction study, which found only, quote, very mild carpal tunnel, and that claimant had good strength in both hands, which is consistent with Dr. Wang's later finding that claimant could make a complete fist, make a full grip and wrist strength bilaterally, could maintain a pinch grip versus resistance. This is also consistent with claimant's own description of her daily activities. She could dress, fasten buttons and hooks, comb her hair, and in fact, on pages 268, she in fact stated that she enjoys digging in her flower bed, looking for rocks, and working on a computer. These are all activities consistently, longitudinally over time that demonstrates an individual who clearly has no problems and states that she enjoys digging an activity that requires significant hand and grip strength, which is simply inconsistent with a claim of severe hand limitations.
Let me ask you this, because it looks like the ALJ didn't favor some of the doctors here, and with respect to Dr. Hopper and Dr. Morgan, said that their opinions lack support in the medical evidence, objective medical evidence, references objective medical evidence. But does it get more specific than that? And it seems like the requirement here is first is to get specific enough without exploring or telling us why.
Well, I think, Your Honor, it's important to look at the entire record. The ALJ actually, in his decision, her decision, excuse me, goes through the entire record, describes all the major opinion pieces of opinion evidence and the objective findings, and only then does she say that the doctor opinions of Dr. Hufford are inconsistent with the objective evidence. You can look at, for example, my discussion of Dr. Cavial, Dr. Platt's conduct study, Dr. Wang's objective findings, and the arthritis panel were all referred to explicitly by the ALJ on page 21 and 22. And only then after that, the ALJ wrote the words, for these reasons, I find that the plaintiff's hand complaints are non-severe. So it's important to read the entire content of the decision. The ALJ does, in fact, go through all the major pieces of pain evidence, describe their contents, and only then does it come to the conclusion that they were inconsistent. I think it's a fair reading, and the court may draw legitimate inferences from the ALJ's decision to reach the outcome, to see the ALJ's logic and reach the ALJ's outcome in resolving these disputed pieces of medical evidence. And moving on briefly to claimant's credibility, indeed, the ALJ correctly pointed out numerous reasons with great specificity why claimant's subjective allegations are less than fully credible. In addition to the descriptions earlier, I talked about digging in the flower bed and working on the computer. Claimant made dramatically inconsistent statements about her own capabilities. In fact, in March 2001, getting to Dr. Morgan's statement, she basically represented that she was largely confined to her own bedroom. However, less than 10 days ago, on February 22, 2011, she told her treatment provider that she worked as a housekeeper, clearly not someone that is largely confined to her bedroom. Claimant also reported that she stopped work because she was laid off, and not because of any medical reason. She had extremely sporadic treatment. As noted earlier, there were treatment gaps, including from June 2007 to December 2008, and then from December 2008 all the way to January 2011, a gap of more than 2 years. Only less than 2 months before her scheduled hearing did she return for treatment, with the doctor noting that she'd like to update arthritis complaints so she can continue disability appeal. This is not the picture of an individual who is disabled or has consistently sought treatment. This is a record that is filled with very minimal complaints, objective evidence of supporting her complaints, rather, and inconsistent treatment, inconsistent compliance with treatment. The record actually shows in 2006 that she had 3 no-shows, in 2007 that she had 2 more no-shows. This is simply not a record that the ALJ improperly concluded that claimant would be disabled. Substantial evidence supports the ALJ's findings for all the reasons stated above, and I respectfully urge this court to affirm the ALJ's decision. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. Mr. Baird, do you have some rebuttal time remaining?
Yes, the important thing to remember is this is a degenerative disease, degenerative osteoarthritis, and the x-rays in 2011 are much worse than they were in 2006. Dr. Hufford's relying on those later x-rays, 2011, as well as first-hand examinations of the deformities caused by the arthritis, especially at the right thumb. There were treatment gaps. One explanation was she couldn't always afford insurance, and that comes out periodically that Dr. Hufford or one of the other doctors will say she hasn't been able to afford this. So under Gamble versus Chater, that would be a basis for not getting as much treatment as would have been good. Dr. Cushman was not ambiguous. He found she was credible for his exam. He weighed everything, saw her in person face to face, and said she will have difficulty with regular attendance, maintaining a regular 8-hour workday schedule, 40 hours a week. So the ALJ didn't deal with that. The ALJ didn't translate it. The ALJ didn't address it with specific and legitimate reasons to reject it or to explain what it might mean or anything else. And with that, if there are no more questions, I'll sit down.
I don't believe there are. Thank you very much. The case just argued is submitted, and we very much appreciate the helpful arguments from both counsel.